If you got your Bibles, get them open to Hebrews chapter 10. I'm going to start right there. Hebrews chapter 10. That's going to kind of set the stage for where we're going today. We're going to look at verses 24 and 25. Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. Those verses say, "And let us consider how we may spur one another toward love and good deeds, not giving up the meeting together, as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another all the more as you see the day approaching." I want to talk about refueling. It's an amazing sight to watch an airplane refuel in midair. You think about that fighter jet that can go 500, 600, maybe even 700 miles an hour has to slow down, and that commercial airliner, which can probably go 400 or 500 miles an hour, they have to match speeds. And that fighter pilot's got to keep that airplane the exact same distance, maybe a plus or minus a foot, to that big tanker. All the time that little boom is going right down there behind him where he can't see, and pumping fuel into his little tank so he can continue on his mission. Now, I have heard stories of pilots taking off from the United States, flying across the ocean, or taking off from England and flying across the Mediterranean, and they refuel somewhere overseas in the Mediterranean. Then they fly on down to Iraq or Kuwait or wherever they're going to do their mission. They do their mission, but they don't have enough fuel to get home. So they got to fly back, and that tanker's got to be there waiting for them, and they've got a rendezvous. What happens if that tanker's not there?
Have a good swim.
They go a little further until their tank says, "I have no more." And then that big, heavy military jet becomes a very poor glider. And they might get that there 30,000-40,000 feet. They might get a number of miles, but if they don't get to land and to a place where they can land safely, yeah, it becomes an anchor, and hopefully they've got a lifeboat or something until somebody can come and rescue them. It's a common sight to see people go to the gas station refueling their cars. We took the great granddaughters home after having them overnight Friday night. And we got to Plant City, and the little thing on my car says, "You've got 22 miles before you run out of gas." We've got to get to Plant City, drop them off, and I like to get my gas at Sam's Club. I just do. They usually have a better price, and we're so used to it. And so I'm thinking, can I make it? We get to Plant City, and we get back on the freeway, and I'm watching the meter go down, 19, 18. We get off here at 98, and I think we've got like 8 miles to go before we run out of gas. We got there, I think it still had 7 miles on it before we ran out of gas. But I only put 14 gallons in a 17-gallon tank, so there must have been 3 gallons in there they weren't telling me about.
That's good.
But we made it. But even ships at sea sometimes have to be refueled. Now you consider that could be amazing, especially if the sea's a little tossy-turny. Those ships can kind of move about a little bit this way, and if they bump into each other, it's just plain nasty. Just kind of like those airplanes. If they bump into each other, one of them, maybe both of them, aren't going to make it home that day. So, oh boy, every once in a while, they need to be refueled. Well, how about you? Have you ever considered that you also need a frequent refueling?
Yeah.
We need food and water. And we like to replace our worn-out clothes every once in a while. Because they do get a little worn out. And we like to wear nicer clothes to church, although some people don't get to. And fortunately, God doesn't judge us by our clothes. He judges us by our hearts. But how about spiritual refueling? Do we as Christians need to be refueled on a regular basis? Here's 3 reasons why spiritual refueling is very important. And I have to apologize that I did not get a handout made for you. And the busy of this week and all these excuses, I didn't get it done. So there. So you can get your pen out, you can write notes in your bulletin, and you can take those notes home and hopefully share them with some other people so they'll know that refueling is important. Turn over to Mark chapter 6, verse 30. I've got that one right there. Mark chapter 6. In Mark chapter 6, Jesus had, the apostles had been sent out two by two. They'd been gone out witnessing, I don't know, for a week or 2 weeks or a month or how long they were gone. But they came back. They were all over Galilee. They were going to other towns and talking to people about Jesus. And now they've come back. They've reported to Jesus. And it's such a busy day in Capernaum that he just kind of says, you know what? In verse 30, the apostles gathered around Jesus and reported to him all that they had done and taught. And then because there were so many people coming and going, they did not even have a chance to eat. He said, come apart with me by yourselves to a quiet place and get some rest. So they went away by themselves into a boat to a solitary place. They thought they were going to take a little vacation, a little weekender maybe. We could go on and talk about how that went. But at least for a while they're in the boat for a few hours, a couple hours, while it takes to travel from Capernaum, maybe 10 miles over, less than that, maybe about 5 miles, 3 to 5 miles over to Bethsaida. So, number one, refueling replenishes. Jesus and the disciples had just had a busy, exciting time as they came back from going out to preach and perform miracles, and they're now gathering back to report. Can you imagine Peter, Andrew, James, and John, and Philip, and Bartholomew, and all those guys are going out, and they're saying to people, walk. They're saying to people, now you can see. They're restoring health to people that are sick. They've never done that before. I would dare say that would be a little energizing. That would be a little, oh, wow. I can touch people's lives. And every one of us wants to touch people's lives and change them for the better. And if you don't want to change them for the better, I wonder why. Maybe you need an attitude change. But that's a different subject. We are constantly spending ourselves. The apostles were excited, but they were also tired and worn out. They needed to refuel. We're constantly expending ourselves in an effort to win the world to Christ. We invite and we try to teach and we try to counsel and we try to expend ourselves in our places of employment to be a Christian example in our work ethic or in encountering others. And sometimes we run low on mental and physical reserves to meet those challenges. Sometimes we need some fuel. And a non-Christian confronts us and challenges or attacks our beliefs, and we run out of fuel trying to respond to their needs. Maybe they just don't care about what we're trying to tell them. And your heart goes out. You want to tell them the saving grace of Jesus. And sometimes it wears you out. And our reserves for engaging complacent and ignorant and hostile forces gets used up. We need to refuel. A refueling encourages. In 1 Corinthians chapter 16, I'm going to have to look that one up so you can look it up with me. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 15 to 18. We're going to be over there in Sunday school in just a couple of weeks, Dan, so here's some notes. If you haven't already got them figured out. 1 Corinthians chapter 16, verses 15 through 18. You know that the household of Stephanas were the first converts in Achaia, and they devoted themselves to the service of the Lord's people. And I urge you, brothers and sisters, submit to such people and to everyone who joins in the work and labors in it. Refueling encourages. He says in verse 17, I was glad when Stephanas, Fortunatus, and Achaeus arrived because they have supplied what was lacking from you. They refreshed my spirit and yours also. Such men deserve recognition. Paul's missionary trip had been very challenging. Often he faced danger, both man and nature, opposition, and actual attempts to kill him. And all sorts of things that would discourage him. Now, every one of you and every one thing that you've done at one time or another, there's been those things that have brought you discouragement. He argued with people who questioned his teachings, and some who even tried to make him look stupid or foolish. He took young men with him, and he tried to train them for ministry of the gospel. And some of them stayed with him, and some of them gave him a hard time, and some of them just totally abandoned him. Been there, done that. You know what's going about. Paul needed refueling. We need encouragement too. We often get discouraged. We're alone and this world is attacking or threatening our beliefs and freedom of religious expression. Someone's challenging our beliefs and we start to feel like we're all alone in this battle. And it's hard to be strong when you feel like everyone around you opposes or does not respect your Christian values. We'll often try to train someone else to do the work we are doing. And we may take it over, maybe they'll take it over and move on after only to see them falter in their efforts. In the letters to the seven churches, let's see where I am. There we go. We're right there. In the letters to the seven churches in Revelation chapter 2 and 3. In every letter, Jesus repeats these words, to him who overcomes. Every one of those churches had a challenge that they were facing. A struggle that they were dealing with. Some obstacle that they needed to overcome. Around or through or over or under somehow. And they had to get by. But to him who overcomes, the victory is. And that's where we are in our lives. We need to refuel by being around people that will encourage us to stand for Christ in the face of opposition. We remember the little battle that Chick-fil-A had. Homosexuals decided to challenge them because they said, we don't believe that men having sex with men is what God honors. And so the homosexuals said, we're going to boycott you, and you're going to face a suffering. Look at the suffering they faced on the day that the homosexuals boycotted Chick-fil-A. I wonder how many of those restaurants ran out of food that day. The Christians stood up and stood with them and encouraged them, and in the same way encouraged one another. Now, one of the earlier pictures you saw just a minute ago was Phil Robertson and Duck Dynasty people having prayer at the end of every program. They had prayer as a part of their program. And CBS says, oh, we don't want you doing that anymore. They said, you don't do that? We don't do our program. CBS found out that they kind of liked that money and that popularity of that program. They decided they better let them continue to pray. And so, yes. Let me go back here. Oh, okay. We've been. I thought I had another one up there. I think it's next.
No, it was one before.
No. There was one more. I know where I'm going. You don't. Well, I think I remember where I'm going.
Yeah.
But we need to be refueled by being around others who will encourage us to stand for Christ. We need to refuel to encourage and not give up in the battle for what we believe in and our faith in Christ Jesus and the work that we're seeking to do. Now, here's one more thing. Refueling strengthens us. Get over to 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 8 to 13. 2 Corinthians chapter 7, verse 8. Paul says, even if I caused you sorrow by my letter, referring back to 1 Corinthians, I do not regret it. Though I did regret it, I see that my letter hurt you, but only for a little while. And yet now I am happy because you were made sorry, not because you were made sorry, but because your sorrow led you to repentance. And for you became sorrowful as God intended, so you were not harmed in any way by us. Godly sorrow brings repentance that leads to salvation and leaves no regret, but worldly sorrow leads to death. See what this godly sorrow has produced in you, that earnestness, that eagerness to clear yourselves, what indignation, what alarm, what longing, what concern, what readiness to see justice done. At every point, you proved yourself to be innocent in this matter. So even though I wrote to you, it was neither on account of the one who did the wrong, nor on account of the injured party, but rather that God could, before God, you could see for yourself how devoted to us you are. By this, we are encouraged. And in addition to our own encouragement, we are especially delighted to see how happy Titus was, because his spirit was refreshed by all of you. So the trials in 1 Corinthians, he's talking about problems, things that the church was doing that weren't honoring God. Little things that us churches, us people in churches sometimes get into. Luke and Titus and Timothy and others had worked along Paul to help him stand strong in the work that he was doing, give some supporting churches where he had preached, helped meet the financial needs as they traveled through and preached the gospel. Those supporting churches and gifts were a strong encouragement to Paul so that he could finish his work in evangelizing. They encouraged him. They strengthened him. When the going got tough, here came some co-workers alongside him to help him stay through in those tough times. And Richard and I can share some of our conversations that we've had with each other as we've challenged and with others of you in this church as we've encouraged one another and fought through some of the struggles that we've fought through. You see, we need to be strengthened. We gain strength from one another like a three-stranded cord braided together is stronger than three strands of cord by themselves. And you've heard that one horse pulling can only pull so much, and you can get this horse pulling this, and this horse pulling this, and this horse pulling this. But if you team them together, they can pull a much bigger load over a much more difficult stance, and they work together to accomplish a greater thing. An army of soldiers fighting together can defeat an enemy far better than individual soldiers fighting with no one around to help. There are some of the movies that have come out about Lone Survivor and American Sniper and some of these others. These guys were teams, and it was amazing to see 13 Hours, I think it was another one. There was a team, and a small team, but because that small team was able to gather together and cover each other, they were able to hold off a whole lot of enemy that were attacking them. And amazing to see what they could do together. Your fellowship here on Sunday mornings, getting together on Bible study on Wednesday night, participating in the things that we can at the nursing homes when you can get there, helps to strengthen one another and keep us active in the fight. Your presence, your prayers, and your giving, participate in various activities, help to strengthen you and those who are impacted by your efforts. Getting refueled strengthens you as well as strengthens others. So now I'd like to talk to you for a minute about how to refuel. So you want to refuel. How do you go about it? What things can you do to help you refuel so you can help others refuel and continue on your journey with Jesus? Well, assembling together. We just read Hebrews chapter 10, verses 24 and 25. Consider how to encourage one another by getting together. Weekly services, worship services, and Bible studies. We need one another. We need the instruction and the fuel that these activities provide. Now, if any of you have a hobby or you have an interest, sports team, you like to go get with other people that like that sports team and watch them play. You've got a hobby like golf or bowling or boating or bike riding. You like to gather with other people that have similar interests, and you encourage one another and you learn from one another and you fuel one another in these activities. Well, the same it is in the worship services of the church. Reading the Bible. Daily reading keeps you strong when others aren't around for encouragement. And so you have that connection. But But how much more is it, too, when you read the same Bible with other people and you find out they believe that same Bible that you believe, and they're reading and they're getting strength and encouragement from it. And they share with you the things that they've read this past week that's blessed them, maybe from a devotion or something. Singing praises. Oh, now, back when, before all this electronic stuff, we might just remember them old songs from Sunday. I'd be riding my bicycle from my home to where the church had an office in Wasco, California. And I'm going down the street singing, sing the wondrous love. And I'm pedaling right along with the singing. I didn't sing out real loud. I probably could have. I might have made some of the people wonder as I rode by. But it was fun to do. But we would sing in praises. And now you see people who run around with these little things in their ears. I hope they're playing Christian music. I can't tell because they're not always singing along with it, but some are, some aren't. But, I mean, sometimes we don't know what it is to be quiet. We like to have noise around us. I guess if I hear something, that means I'm alive. And so we've got the TV on. Some of us a Christian station, or we've got a radio on to... Maybe sometimes a Christian station playing Christian music, or your car radio, or you've got those little things in your ears, or you got it on your phone and you're listening to it. We love music. Music is so powerful. Daily inspiration. Music has a tremendous power over one's psyche and emotions. Just being in worshiping together, singing songs and singing praises, it kind of gets us in the right mood. It gets us in the attitude. And a lot of times, how many times have you sung a song and that song just happened to just be the right song for what was going on inside you? Yeah, I hope that as we pick the songs for Sunday, that they just kind of touch that something in here that in you that needs to get out and just communicate with God. And it encourages one another also. Praying daily. Talking to God regularly helps you stay focused on your need for Him and allows Him to participate in the battles that you are fighting. I like these kids praying around the flagpole at the beginning of the school year. There have been some who have tried to silence that. You know, there's been a major effort to get God and prayer and the Bible out of our schools, and yet there is a resistance. And when you get together with your classmates and you gather around that flagpole, they just can't stop that because you're doing that before school. And listening to sermons, weekly instruction and guidance and encouragement, weekly worship services, and now with today's technology, we can even put a message up on YouTube. And if you didn't get to hear this sermon, I hope that some of the people that didn't get to come today will listen to this sermon on YouTube and say, you know what? No wonder I'm feeling run down and empty. I need to get back over there at the church and refuel. Giving is an act of worship. Weekly or as often as God leads you to give, it's an act of worship because they're saying, God, I value your work ahead of other things I might could have spent that money on. And all of us have that choice, and we all have that ability to say, God, I love you and I want to express my love for you. How many times have maybe you done something nice for somebody? You just did it out because they had a need and you just stopped and helped them because you had the ability. And they wanted to give you some money for shopping and helping them. And maybe you took it and said thank you, and maybe you said no, I just did this because I you needed help and I wanted to help you. And maybe you do like the other guy says, well, don't give it to me. You give that to somebody else. You give that to somebody else who has a need. And maybe they did. And you paid it forward. And somebody else got blessed. But it's an act of worship. It's an act of showing value. And so it is important. Partaking of the Lord's Supper. Weekly or as often as you seek to remember His death on the cross and your sins. Fortunately, by the grace and power of God, it is not required weekly. Or weekly is not too often. You know what? It's more your heart. God, I want to remember what you did on the cross for me. And when we do it in the assembly, we're encouraging one another. You're partaking of the Lord's Supper says that you believe that Jesus is Christ, the Son of God. And I see you partaking of the Lord's Supper, and you see me partaking of the Lord's Supper. That means we're all on the same team. We're all fighting the same battle. We're all working to encourage and strengthen one another in this challenge. You know, we go to church on Sunday. I got this from both Ray and Morgan this past week. Both of them sent it to me, so I'm going to share this with you. Jesus established the church as an entity where we might be replenished spiritually, encouraged by others of like faith and mind, and taught more about God's word and God's ways so that we might be found faithful as we live our lives for Him. So, why go to church on Sunday? A churchgoer wrote a letter to the editor of a newspaper and complained that it made no sense to go to church every Sunday. He wrote, "I've gone to church for 30 years now, and in that time I've heard something like 3,000 sermons, but for the life of me, I can't remember a single one of them." Did you guys know what I was preaching on this week? The Holy Spirit must have guided you in that. So this person says, "I think I'm wasting my time, and the preachers and the priests are wasting their time giving sermons at all." This started a real controversy in that newspaper, letters to the editor. So much to the delight of the editor, it went on for weeks until somebody wrote this clincher. "I've been married for 30 years now. You notice all this food I put up here? In that time, my wife has cooked some 32,000 meals, give or take a few. But for the life of me, I cannot recall the entire menu for even a single one of those meals. Let's see, last night we had leftover chicken lasagna, green beans, and
a salad
and a brownie.
Bread.
I remembered the one we had the night before. I don't know, but it was good. I ate it. I don't think it gave me heartburn, so I slept well that night. But I know this. All those meals have nourished me and gave me strength, and I needed to do my work. If my wife had not given me those meals, I'd be physically dead today. Unless I learned to cook for myself. Some guys would be dead. Likewise, if I had not gone to church for nourishment, I would be spiritually dead today. When you are down to nothing, God is up to something. Faith sees the impossible. Church meetings are a refueling station. Jesus established the church as an entity where we might be replenished spiritually, encouraged by others of like faith and mind, and taught more about God's word and God's way so that we might be found faithful as we live our lives for Him on this earth. Are you being refueled? Just let me ask a question real quick. Have you been refueled this morning?
Sure.
All right. Some of you said yes. Others of you have got the head bob disease. All right. That works. Are you ready to go out and engage people with the power and the healing love of Jesus Christ? Are you a soldier for Christ in the army of God? Be refueled and come back to church next Sunday. We'll have another refueling. So, now it's time to come to Jesus. And we have an invitation song. Andrew, you going to help us out with this one? I just...